Okay. Learning from our mistakes, a postmortem of Guacamelee. That's my talk. I'm Chris Harvey. I'm one of the co-founders of DrinkBox. What does that mean? It means that I own a chunk of the company. I lead the technical development on the team, but like sort of in fancy terms, you might call me also an executive producer. Like, I'm involved in all the business decisions. I'm constantly reviewing what's happening with the development of the projects. I handle lots of little things because we're a small company. So why am I doing this talk? Making games is not so easy. We've made a few. We've made 3 games. And our first game was, it was okay, not great. Our most recent game was much better. And, you know, because I help run the company, it's really interesting and important to me to try to understand how you make your team better, your product better, the environment better, and so on. And so I thought that I would try to present to people here some information about how we think that we managed to make our games better. In particular, I'm going to talk about the important changes we made, or we think we made, between our first game, About a Blob, and our most recent title, Guacamelee. So in case you're not familiar with Guacamelee at all, I'm just going to show a brief trailer for the game. Sorry about doing it this way. PowerPoint does not play the movies fast enough. Okay, so just to give an overview of what I'm going to do here. Sorry, the slideshow is fighting me. I'm going to talk about how we changed our concept process, changes we made to our development process, how we modified our marketing process, and then some conclusions, some platitudes, hopefully something sort of useful in the conclusions. Sorry, technical problem. All right, into the concept stuff. So I'm just going to give a bit of background on our first game so you can understand sort of how we built it and some intro on why things kind of went wrong. And then I'm going to talk about how we, from that project, how we just completely changed or adjusted our process in terms of choosing a concept, in terms of defining the game that we were making, and how we approached making the game fun. The founding members of the studio had worked previously on retail console games. Most of us had either lead roles or senior roles, but we had no business or production experience. And that retail experience gave us some advantages, like we had some idea how to get a game onto a console, we understood what it meant, you know, to finish something and polish it. But it also gave us a bunch of disadvantages that I think indie developers who haven't worked in retail actually have, which is that we, coming from a retail perspective, we had this thing in our brains about trying to compete largely on scope and production value. Because we bootstrapped the company at the beginning using contracts, it took a long time for the first game to get completed, and our attention was not focused. Basically, the main founders, the three initial founders were all programmers, and that meant that we could make money doing contracts on other games. So we would take that money, and then we would pay people internally with salaries out of that money. But it meant that we were constantly on other projects, and our focus was spread. About a Blob was not a success. Although not exactly a failure, we basically broke even on the project. And it was near the end of that project before we had finished it, but at a point where we knew that it wasn't fundamentally going to change, that we started concepting our next game. So just to let you, you definitely may not be familiar with this game, so I'll just play the launch trailer for About a Blob as well. Okay, so I'm going to phrase most of the slides in this sort of problem and then change construct. So first problem with the concept of About a Blob. So the team decided on this concept in consensus. Nobody sort of objected to it. We all agreed on it. Coming from retail games, we were pretty tired of hyper-aggressive games with a lot of gray or brown textures. And so going in this completely different direction felt very fresh for us. The visual style said family-friendly. The gameplay was puzzly. There was no punching. There were not really any guns. There were zero zombies. And releasing the game on download PSN is probably not the best place for a game like that. Like I said, the game was chosen by consensus, but maybe not with full consideration for the platforms that we intended to put it out on. So the key change that we made as we were starting Guacamelee, first we sat everybody down day after day after day in this basement room in the building, and we discussed a lot of things. We talked about what we thought would fit the studio, what people on the team were excited about making, the goals of the studio. We did kind of a pre-release postmortem of About a Blob as it was. People just threw it out. It was just a broad brainstorming session as well, like people threw out ideas for game mechanics and setting. We had all the different disciplines in the room to try to get their perspective on how each discipline thought we should adjust the studio's trajectory. And so after spending a lot of time doing this, we asked everybody to create single-page pitch sheets for us to look at. I'm going to show the Guacamelee one of these. Each person was asked to come in with at least one pitch for a game. The pitches had to state a genre, a platform, a target market, and the concept that followed that had to actually make sense with those things. So there was this kind of gut check. Every time we would look at the thing, we would read it, and then we would look at the parameters, and we would say, this makes sense, or this is inconsistent. And the result was a kernel for several different game concepts. So if you can actually read the stuff there, what you'll see is that this version of Guacamelee is supposed to be more of a traditional brawler, you know, in sort of the isometric mode, kind of like a Castle Crashers. But there were a bunch of other game concepts. So the dimension swapping that's in the game was for a different kind of game. The concept of using combat moves for platforming was just a mechanic that somebody else had suggested. And so this concept, which everybody was really interested in right away, partly because of the tone and the character and the art and the fact that it fit more of a hardcore vibe, the whole group kind of refined the concept over time with ideas from other pitches. So we had a concept, actually we had a couple of concepts, but this is the one that ended up surviving longest. We had a concept. In About a Blob, once we had the concept, we really struggled to define what the game was. The initial concept was, okay, you're a giant blobby monster that gets bigger as you eat things, and you're gonna basically eat the Earth. That's sort of the high level concept. But when it came to the details of the universe and the tone and the gameplay, we had an extremely difficult time coming to a clear vision. Was it a B monster movie? Or was it a Saturday morning cartoon? It kind of evolved between one and the other. Was it a puzzle game? Or was it an action game? Or was it an exploration game? That wasn't really in the initial pitch. Was it hardcore or casual? Not exactly defined. So in terms of identity, the game in the end kind of straddled all of these things. And as a result, it was extremely non-committal. It didn't really go far enough in any direction. With this in mind, when we started working on, once we had the initial concept for Guacamelee and we started trying to flesh it out a bit, the goal in everyone's mind was we have to focus the game immediately on what's important. Any loose threads or things that were vague about the universe of the gameplay were a major red flag that everybody had to get stressed about right away. Defining those things took a long time. The pre-production for the game was 8 months. The whole development cycle was 19 months, although it kind of took longer in real time because there was another game that got shipped in the middle there. But it was 19 months, so almost half the time was spent in pre-production trying to nail down the basics. And we iterated on everything, on the visual style, on the gameplay, on the tone. So I'm just going to show a bit of that evolution. So on the left side is the first sort of sell sheet that we made for the game. And as you can see, it's very kid-friendly. It's very much in the blob style. And I remember looking at this sheet once it was kind of in semi-complete form and looking at one of the other fans and going, what is going on? Because the sheet was made by the artists who themselves were pushing for a more aggressive look to the game. Yet somehow, through habit, it came back to this soft, kid-friendly approach. And I guess it just kind of reflects the difficulty or the effort that's required in order to make sure that everybody is focused on what we're actually trying to accomplish. On the right is the second thing we made. It was like a 3-page description of the game, and it was definitely in a different direction, away from Kitty, although maybe not actually a producible style. Here's some sort of screenshots as they progressed. On the top left, that's a mock-up. It's closer, it's more aggressive. It feels kind of Mexican, but then it's sort of full of ghosts and ghouls, which wasn't in the thrust of what we were trying to accomplish. We wanted something that felt authentic and different, you know, and ghosts and ghouls felt predictable. The top right is our vertical slice, which is cleaner, more in the style we were hoping for, but it's not exciting. It doesn't really pop yet. Bottom left, that was the first publicly playable demo and pretty close to the final look. And then bottom right, that's the final look. So I guess you could say it was just a constant iterate. I mean, I'm choosing the visual ones because those are the easiest to express. But this was sort of true of everything. This constant, like, this is the wrong direction. Focus, 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 focus. Constantly struggling to bring the team in line with the initial vision. Okay, in terms of finding the fun, on About a Blob, the gameplay was kind of a little bit Katamari Damacy and a little bit Mario. Figuring out how to do the physics-y gameplay at vastly different scales, because the blob gets really huge within the same level, with imprecise platforming, with all the various other mechanics that we put in, Even though the game is just, on the surface, looks like this just kind of simple side-scrolling game, it was unintentionally extremely ambitious, because we basically had to figure out how to do things that there were not very many examples of out there in other games. In particular, how to combine them. The best levels were the hardest to build in About a Blob, because they typically it was a little bit more exploratory and playful with large changes in scale, which was difficult for the designers to put together. And so it was really hard to keep people focused on those strong elements, because it was much easier to create something that in practice was not as fun. It felt like we were kind of starting to get it near the end of the project, but the project's over. For Guacamelee, in those initial meetings, the tone was set. The tone was, stop being so crazy and get way more conservative with the fundamentals of the game. So Guacamelee's gameplay is side-scrolling. Why? Well, we have a side-scrolling engine, so let's reuse that. Let's not reinvent the wheel there. Why more traditional platforming rather than this blobby stuff? Well, because there are a lot of examples that you can look at out there to see, you know, what works well and what doesn't work well. We removed the physics gameplay from the engine because it's a source of constant bugs. Just getting things to work at all was extremely painful. And obviously punching, you know, the brawler aspect had a clear hardcore appeal, but again, there were games that we could look at as a starting point in order to get the fundamentals in. So we still had a lot of unknowns, like does Metroidvania plus brawling equal fun? Does combining attacks with platforming actually, is that actually entertaining? Yeah, there were a lot of things that we were trying that we hadn't quite seen before, but the fundamentals were not unknown. The basic fundamentals of the game were much more conservative than what we'd done before. So that's the concept issues. To summarize, first, we were much more careful about the game genre and art style we chose. We wanted the concept to attract immediate excitement and also target it properly at people who were buying download-only games. Second, we slowly and carefully defined the tone and spent a huge amount of energy constantly keeping everyone focused on making sure that vision was clean and clear. A bit more on that later. Third, we were just much more consistent about the fundamental mechanics of the game so that we could spend more time refining the game and trying to make it fun rather than just making it work. So onto the development. So I'll talk a bit about how our pre-production process changed, how we adjusted our approach to deadlines, some direction changes we made in terms of adding personality to the game, some tool set and process changes towards just making the game, and a little bit of discussion of why we chose our target platform. In terms of pre-production, during About a Blob, because the founders were on contracts, different founders were on the project at each time, and then they would kind of shift off. And the result is there was a lot of sort of rebooting and second guessing that came from that, as one person who didn't understand why certain decisions had been made questioned all those decisions, and then maybe changed a bunch of them. So we kept basically rebooting the game, trying different directions. And that lack of a clear vision plagued the general production. Like level designs for levels were very inconsistent, or like I said before, they might focus on the weakest parts of the game instead of the strongest parts of the game. So for the Guacamelee pre-production, what we did is, first we said, okay, we're gonna take all the founders off of external contracts. We still did some external contracts, but none of the founders, I guess you could call those the stakeholders, the key stakeholders, none of those guys were on external contracts. Two of the founders focused full-time on Guacamelee while the other founder was working on a different project, but we were in constant discussion about exactly what was going on and why. We limited the number of people on the team. By this point, the team was like, I don't know, maybe we were like 12 people in the studio. That experience before of people second-guessing, we wanted to avoid that. So we limited the number of people we had. We had one designer, we had basically one artist, one programmer, and a producer to try to avoid too many cooks in the kitchen. And we took baby steps with the production. So we didn't define a vertical slice early, whereas on a better blog, we were constantly redefining new vertical slices, hoping to get it right. We said, we're not going to worry about the vertical slice yet. We're just gonna work on these small little pieces and get those working properly, and then we'll decide what the vertical slice is supposed to be later. We set a lot of deadlines in About a Blob, but the deadlines were always failures. Not in the sense that we didn't hit the deadlines, we always hit the deadlines. But the game wasn't good at those deadlines. And so we would set another deadline, another vertical slice deadline, and then that deadline would also fail. There was this thing we were trying to do, like I alluded to in the last, that we were trying to basically put the whole game together at once without examining the individual pieces. So the change we made, there were two aspects to the change. First, we set deadlines every few months like we'd done before, but we changed them to very small and attainable goals and then tried to fit those pieces together slowly instead of all at once. At the same time, almost all of our deadlines were shown externally, which we hadn't exactly done in the past, in order to collect feedback, also to create tension on the team, because when you're not creating a deadline, when you're not creating a vertical slice, it can be hard to kind of get the team, I feel, it can be hard to get the team kind of focused and intense on what they're trying to do. So showing publicly meant that there was going to be some kind of tension in anything we did, a pitch, a drawing, whatever. We showed to publishers doing pre-production. We showed to the public after pre-production for basically all of our deadlines. And as a result, the deadlines had to be polished, so the team got to practice polish. We got to see what each person on the team was capable of, which was very important. It let us practice planning, and it let us practice cutting. It gave us a lot of practice at figuring out what was the most important stuff that we needed to get into whatever the deliverable was. Which is different than my experience working on retail games. I haven't worked on a retail game that actually scored very high on Metacritic. But my experience there was there's this thing with a public showing where you're just kind of throwing the kitchen sink in all the time. So the sequence was we made a one-page pitch, that was for publishers. We made a three-page pitch with mock-up screenshots, that was also for publishers. We made a concept video and a combat demo, which we showed to publishers, and I'm going to show that in a second to give you some idea of sort of how rough it was how rough the stuff is that we were willing to show. We made a playable intro, so not really a vertical slice, but approaching it, and we intended to send that to publishers, but we didn't quite feel good enough about it yet, so we didn't. And we made a playable demo for the IGF next, and then finally we made a bigger playable demo, and that was our first PAX demo, our first public showing. So I'm going to show the concept video that we made. This was made completely in Flash, so there wasn't really any, like, the game didn't work at this time. It's interesting for me to see look at that concept video because when I look at it now, what I realize is that basically we had the whole game in that concept video. There are some very important differences, but the essence of the game and how the game feels and flows and to a large degree what the combat like was all in that video before we even had the game. Next, I'm going to show the combat demo that we showed to publishers. I'm just gonna show a bit of it because it's long. You get the idea. So yeah, we showed those to publishers. The response to the concept video was sort of like, you know, sort of cautious interest. I mean, at that point in the project, you know, the publishers are always positive no matter what, basically, unless it's really bad. You know, they don't want to, you know, cut off the tree before they can see what's coming out. Although we did get some comments like, oh, your game looks like a Flash game, which it was. In the combat demo, if you look at that, you know, the combat in that demo is way more complicated than the actual game. And that's kind of an example of like that vision thing again, where we started to drift away with the combat and make it really complicated. And then later there was a turning around and bringing it back to the core vision and simplifying it. About a Blob it had personality, it had humor, it had an identity. But it just wasn't really, it wasn't zany, exactly. I mean, it felt like we were playing kind of safe with that game. So for Guacamelee, one of the things that we did is we decided to just say yes to more stuff. Now, what stuff you say yes to is a challenging problem, but just changing the mindset from no to yes was an important adjustment for us. So we tried to more aggressively grab humor and personality from multiple people on the team. We would have team meetings all the time to see in progress stuff from all the departments. And people would say, you know, during those things like, you know what, we should have a chicken head pop out at the side here. Or we should have, you know, or they would suggest a character or some way in which the combat would change. And so we would write those down. The producer would write those down and would just kind of shove it in. We would let people on the team, because it's a small team, so this was scalable. We would let people on the team just kind of like put stuff in, like, oh, I'm working on this task, but while I'm at it, I think I'm going to make this guy say something. We would let them put that in, understanding that maybe we're going to take it out later. But we would let people kind of just experiment and express their personality into the game. I think, you know, the overall effect was, first of all, a much more a positive atmosphere on the team. Like, people were excited about what they were putting into the game. But also, we were finding people on the game who had certain talents that we didn't really expect. Like, one of the programmers on the team, he did a fair bit of dialogue in the game, and he's done dialogue since. And, you know, he has this sense of humor. You wouldn't necessarily expect to get the programmer involved in the dialogue for the game, but it's something that really worked. So I guess I could say that even though About a Blob did have humor and personality, I think. So the change here wasn't in degrees, but it was kind of, there's kind of a mental shift from no or playing it safe to yes, let's see how far we can push it. And here's some examples of those things that people just kind of pushed in on their own. So on the left, internet memes, which were somewhat controversial, but nevertheless added a lot of personality and character. On the top right, we have these sort of these power-up animations that would come in when you got a power. That was something that just kind of happened at the end based on a suggestion. The suggestion was like, it would be much better if you got, you know, the game needs these little interstitial animations. And I bet we can do it really cheap by just using our art that we already have. Flameface, the character, that was sort of just a joke. We were talking about, oh, who should the bad guys be? There's a bunch of bad guys put out there. And one idea was, well, we should just have a guy with a flame for a face. It was just sort of a flip comment. And then it became, you know, a joke like, yeah, flame face, that flame face guy. And then over time, yeah, we just kind of pushed it into the game. Turning into the chicken, a similar thing, you know, the question is asked, Where are the chickens? There should be chickens in the game. Okay, we put chickens in. Now we should punch the chickens. Okay, we start punching the chickens. Then we should be a chicken. Okay, it goes into the game. In terms of the tool set, okay, so I think, you know, it's important when you're making the game to be able to throw stuff away and to change stuff really fast. For a better blob, we could kind of do that, but we couldn't do it fast enough. We were using our own proprietary engine, and so there was a lot of thinking about how to change our development process to be faster. We considered changing to maybe some other middleware engine, but moved away from that after considering the advantages that we'd received from our own engine in terms of portability. Like, we were able to do a launch title on Vita as a result of our own engine, just sort of the independence that it brings. Instead, what we did is we focused on making a lot of incremental changes in a lot of different places, with a couple examples to follow, with the key kind of thrust being that we wanted to make an attitude change where people would kind of reflect more on how efficient their process was and look for ways to simplify what they were doing. So problem one, we made, I hope it's visible, yeah. So the collision hulls for About a Blob, they had to be made extremely precisely and smoothly, because the blob is a blob and he needs to not get caught up on corners. And that takes a lot of time for designers to do. As you can see, the game world there, you can see exactly what you're looking at, or you have some idea, oh, here's a gear and here's a crusher or something. The art team would import this stuff in a 3D Studio Max, but they couldn't use that stuff in Max. They had to use it as a guide for what they would make. And so the iteration process was slow and painful. So we switched from this kind of curvy hull stuff to a rectilinear style, more a traditional platformer style, so the designers could plop down blocks. We didn't remove the ability to do the custom work, but it was just kind of a process thing that generally they didn't use it. And the artists, they were able to import these hulls as flat geometry and just use it as geometry in 3D Studio and apply textures on top of it, so we could very quickly get something vaguely passable into the game. And when there were changes to the level geometry, it wasn't that big a deal to fix it. A similar problem, in About a Blob, we had pretty weak visual effects. We went to a PAX, and we sat beside Retrograde, which, if you're familiar with that game, has an enormous number of effects. And it was just depressing to see how far off we were from another indie developer. Our visual system, our effects system was visual driven, so it was intended for the design, for the artists to be able to use these visual tools to make their effects. But in practice, the artists didn't, I don't know, like it, or it just wasn't good enough. And the designers ended up making all the effects, and then those effects, you know, I mean, they're not artists. The artists are going to be better at that kind of stuff, so it wasn't great. So after thinking about it for a while, first we thought, well, maybe we'll make the tools better, but that's expensive, it's hard. It's a difficult problem. So instead, we flipped it around completely, and we said, you know what, we're not going to make the tools better for the artists. What we're going to do is we're going to make the tools better for the programmers, and we're going to let the programmers drive the effects. So we made changes to the engine so that we could put shaders into the engine much more easily and quickly, that you could make more changes on the fly. And we added a system so that the programmers could easily put handles on their shaders so that the artists could tune the shaders. So we changed into this process where it was actually the programmers driving the initial effects. Like, oh, I think we should have smoke here, or a waterfall, or something like that. We would make these prototype effects, add handles to them, and then the artists would tune them. So they wouldn't make the effects, but they would refine the effects, make them arty, make them just way better than the programmers could do. Finally, I'll talk sort of quickly about the target platform. We released our previous games on PS3 and PS Vita. Our first About a Blob was a PubFun game, which means you get there's an advance against royalties arrangement, but you get paid after the project ships, so you have to be able to finance the project to that point. For Guacamelee, we decided, you know what, we're going to just reevaluate everything. The change was, there was no change. We ended up doing exactly the same thing, but only after a lot of thinking about it and talking to people and looking at all our options. So I guess you could say there wasn't a change exactly in the outcome, but there was more of a more aggressive change in attitude. Like, we have to be very aggressive about questioning our presumptions about what's the right thing for us to do. So just some brief logic for why we ended up doing what we did. Why in consoles? Because we have experience there, because there's some barriers to entry there, and so if you can get over those barriers, it's good for you as a developer. Why PSN? Why self-publish? The studio is in a position to largely or entirely self-finance the game, so we didn't need a publisher. We've had some bad experiences of our own with publishers when we were working on retail games. A couple of us worked on a project where a game that was supposed to be a port was, for marketing reasons, labeled as a sequel, which meant that the team was crushed under work, and it was impossible for the game to get a good review. Another experience was one of the other founders. He worked on retail games for PC, They had a publishing deal, the game was on the shelves, the game was selling. The publisher simply refused to give them any royalties. So we were afraid of that, but we talked to publishers all the time. And for every project, we tried to pitch it to publishers in the hopes that maybe there could be an arrangement, something that would make sense for both sides, but also because they see a lot of games. And so we would show them the game, and we would just try to gauge or read between the lines in their feedback. They see a lot of pitches. We're trying to leverage that experience for our own benefit. So we talked to Sony about PubFund early. They made an offer. It wasn't quite what we were hoping for. We showed the game publicly. It got a great response. We started talking to publishers. We were very close to signing with a publisher. And then Sony came back and gave us a slightly different offer for the PubFund. And because of our good working relationship with them, because we had actually had good trust with them, we knew that there weren't going to be shenanigans. And because philosophically the company founders are conservative financially, we were very concerned about our minimum return rather than maximizing our return. It seemed like a great deal for us, so we did it. So to summarize, we had key team members attached to the project day-to-day, like key founders, with a strong vision in place, and so we could focus on building the pieces one by one. We used external deadlines to drive the development, and that dovetailed with the marketing, which I'll talk about next, and we showed all our milestones externally. We became more free with letting ideas into the game, trying to pull out the personality of the team. And off-the-cuff stuff was taken seriously, but also vetted by the producer. We kept our existing engine, but we focused changes in places where there were productivity issues. So instead of making the engine more complicated, we looked at ways of simplifying our processes or making things more efficient. And finally, we went through the same distribution channel again, but only after a lot of thought. It was useful for us to explore all our options again. Okay, so into the marketing. I'll talk a bit about how we chose to change how we revealed the game, relationship with marketing in general, an attitude change with respect to launching the game. So with About a Blob, it just seemed like nobody knew that the game existed when it came out. When an article would go up, the comments would suggest that most people had never heard of the game. You could tell that because they would engage in a flame war about how the game was clearly ripped off from Gish. There was just low anticipation, and there were very few day one reviews. We were very precious with About a Blob. We were scared to show it frequently or in an early state because we were scared that things might change and it would somehow confuse people out there. We were concerned about polish, that it wasn't to a high enough standard. So for Guacamelee, because that obviously didn't work, we just said, okay, we're just going to put it out there the whole time. We're not going to hide it. We're going to put things out pretty early. So because the deadlines were based around showings, we kind of frequently had these things that we could show. We announced the game not even when we were fully out of pre-production. And thereafter, we just tried to attend any public shows that we possibly could. We went to PAX, we had presence at GameCom, we went to E3, fortunately we got an Indiecade, we were at GDC, but we would also do local shows in Toronto, in New York, in London. People would sometimes email and say, hey, we think your art is cool, could your game be at our event? And we're like, sure, here's a build, just send the build in. We first revealed around IGF 2011 with an announcement trailer, and like I said, we were just exiting pre-production. So why reveal then? We had something we thought was interesting. We were committed to the game, and it also helped put pressure on the team to deliver. So I'm just going to show the announcement trailer to give you some idea, if you can remember the old video. sort of how early, comparatively early this is. So yeah, I don't know what you guys see. It looks awful. That's all I see. It looks, the environments look bad. I see all sorts of gameplay problems, jerking of the camera and stuff like that. The point is to say, I don't know what you see, is that we felt nervous about it. We forced ourselves to put it out anyway. And as you can see also, we used part of the concept video at the beginning there, kind of reusing stuff. For about a blob, the quality of coverage from media outlets was pretty bad. We did all our own marketing on the first game. We were extremely green. We were not sure how to do things, or in what order to do things, or even what good results would look like or should look like. But we saw other independent developers doing it themselves, and so we thought, oh, well, then naturally we should do it ourselves. And in retrospect, that was not a good idea. In part because we don't really have, especially at the time, didn't really have good personalities on the team for pitching the game ourselves. So we hired a PR firm near the end of, there were like three projects, About a Blob, Mutant Blobs Attack, and then Guacamelee. We hired a PR firm near the end of Mutant Blobs Attack, and we did that because we went to a PAX, and there was another indie game in front of us, which is sort of similar kind of game in a lot of ways. And we noticed that they were getting a huge amount of press attending their booth. And we went up and we talked to them and we looked at what they were doing, and it turned out that they were kind of signed on with some small publisher, and the publisher had hired a PR firm, and the PR firm was just bringing all these media people to the booth. And we realized we're being idiots. So yeah, we worked with a PR firm basically throughout the entirety of Guacamelee's production. I mean, not in a continuous flow, but like every time there was going to be some kind of event, we would get back in touch and work with them. So they helped us arrange stuff with the trade shows and do key announcements. They organized meetings, advised on approach, timing. They helped us later with our press tour. They facilitated relationships. It's obvious, but it's a job. There's a reason why people have a job doing this. They know something if they've been doing it. We know nothing, so we should try to work with somebody who knows something in order to learn. Finally, the launch also went very poorly. There were basically no previews. The Metacritic review count wasn't too bad for a small indie game, but a lot of them came in late. Not great store placement, although it wasn't terrible because we were in PubFun, Sony was supportive. And we were crushed under other games. Stacking released the same day. Plants vs. Zombies released the same day. Bionic Commando 2 released 1 week before. There was another indie game called Explodemon that released the same day. And we didn't know that. We didn't know that that was happening until a week before. And then when we heard of that, we were like, oh, okay, well, should we change? And we're like, I don't think, it's too much effort. So the change, I mean, not one change, just sort of waking up. We took the launch extremely seriously for Guacamelee. We planned it long in advance. There are many differences. We did a proper press tour multiple weeks before, so we had a proper preview build that we could leave with people. We attended a lot of trade shows near the launch so we could get coverage. We were fortunate to be in the IGF, but we went to GDC and we were in the Sony booth. We were at PAX East. We had some award nominations around that time, so we got kind of coverage from that. But because we planned it properly, we had proper previews and proper reviews. The PR firm helped us set a proper embargo date. We had an exclusive review, which meant that we had great placement. That was on IGN. We had excellent store placement thanks to Sony. We worked closely with Sony on this. We talked to them, tried to figure out when is a good time, when are there not going to be games coming out. We even moved our dates around because we realized that there was another indie game. It was Monaco, was coming out when we planned to come out. And we talked to them and said, oh, maybe there's a problem. And they weren't worried about it, but we were very worried about it. So we just moved our dates back. So I guess overall you could say, as I say, not one thing, just everything. Like, this is a serious issue. We were, very naive initially. So to summarize, we put the game out there into the world constantly. We didn't hide it, and we let it change as we went and didn't worry about that, because it was more important to kind of create awareness, especially for a small title like ours. We accepted that we needed help, so we hired a PR firm. In a way, that's like, it's kind of an ego thing, right? Like, I can do it. We're indie. We can do anything. But we can't. And finally, we took the launch extremely seriously, whereas we hadn't, you're at the end of the project, you're exhausted. It's just such a big deal to even finish a game and get it done. We changed our point of view. Like, it's not done until 3 or 4 months after the game is released. So, wrapping up. The results, I'm doing the talk because the results were good. The game was a success. It was well received. It got strong reviews. It sold well. We continue to release it. It's going to come out soon on additional platforms. Basically, it just eclipses our first game in almost every single way. A few takeaway concepts, generalities. On the concept side, I think having a clear vision for the game was absolutely critical for us. It informed what we made. It determined how people responded to the game after first hearing about it, because we'd worked on a good initial concept. And having that tight vision gave us this guidepost that just made the development flow. On the development side, there are a lot of things to pick on or to pick from, but probably the most important was our attempt to more aggressively pursue simplicity and focus. Sort of trying to be more efficient about what we did meant simplifying things, cutting things, focusing on the most important elements. Which is scary, especially coming from retail, because in retail, there's this psychology, which is like, in order to compete with other retail games, we have to just put more stuff in. It has to have this. It has to have online multiplayer. It has to have these things. And what we kind of slowly realize is that that's totally wrong, particularly for download-only games. And finally, in the marketing, just the term always on. Instead of doing something, being something that we did at the end, it was something that we were always doing, something we're having weekly meetings about, that we took seriously throughout the entire development. So that's it. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. I think we have about 10 minutes.
Yeah. Yep. Thank you very much. Very inspiring. Just one question, if you can disclose any ballpark figures about the PR firm that you worked with. In other words, if they worked on a fixed price or on revenue share or things like that.
A fixed price per month.
And
monthly fee, like a few thousand dollars a month.
A few thousand dollars a month. Okay, thank you.
When it came to sell, no, go ahead.
Thank you. Hi, I was wondering how long did the development took, and how long did you originally estimate it?
Sorry, the question is how long was our development, and how long did we think the development was going to take initially? So yeah, the development was 19 months, 8 months pre-production, and then the rest production. How long did we think it was going to take? We thought it was going to take around that time. I think we basically figured it's going to take like a year and a half to 2 years, and then whatever our estimate is, let's add like 6 or 8 months to that. That was kind of our attitude.
Thank you.
When it came to selecting your PR firm, how many different firms did you look at, and do you have any advice for everyone for like things to look out for or certain questions to ask?
We interviewed a bunch, and then we worked with one for a while, and then we ended up going with another one based on another recommendation. I wasn't that closely involved in the decision of the exact PR firm. I mean, we interviewed a few. We interviewed maybe 5 or 6 initially and get a feel and just sort of feel of like, partly it was like, how connected are they to people and how much do they get the game and how much do they get the scene of the game? Those were kind of the things that we were looking for. Yeah. And then when we made the switch, it was based on the vouch of somebody else who we knew. And they were like, you know, you should totally talk to these guys because I think they're great. And I mean, that's kind of how, that's the world of work, right? Like, depressingly, mostly you kind of get jobs because people vouch for you. And we're very happy with the people we went with for the vouch. Yeah.
I'm curious about, like, at the very beginning of pre-production, when you're trying to decide on this on the concept, the Guacamelee Mexican-inspired world and the brawler, you talked about like several founders that seemed to probably have the most influence. I'm wondering what that process was like, if there was someone who had their idea and they were really bummed that you were going with the Guacamelee idea, and for months they were kind of pissed off, and then they finally got on board because they saw how cool it was, or was there anything like that happening?
I think, you know, so there were sort of 3 key founders, myself and 2 other guys, and we all liked the Guacamelee thing, but I had another idea and I was pissed off that we weren't going with my idea. But I didn't get pissed off for very long, because it's like, when the rest of the team obviously likes it, then why are you holding on to your ego? And I think that's the thing with the 3 of us. We all have slightly different personalities, you know, and so then there's members on the team who are of the 3 founders, there's like one guy who's the most ego-less, and sort of then, because he's there and he's ego-less, it pushes your ego down, so you're like, you know, we need to be practical, we need to be honest. So that does happen, but at the end of the day, I mean, we kind of take the attitude of, you know, if everybody likes it and I'm not so sure, then maybe I should be going with everybody. Yeah.
A couple questions. Thanks for doing the talk, by the way. First question, as far as play testing and stuff, did you guys mostly just rely on yourselves and family and things like that, or did you try to do outside sort of play test scenarios?
A lot of the early stuff was internal, and then it would be family members. We actually did a broader test through Steam. We put the game, we had like a Steam ID, and we made it the beta available to a lot of people who we knew. And then we put metrics into the game. Like we had surveys to give us information, but then we had metrics in the game, like where were they dying, and what were they using the moves properly, and where were they using them? And we would have them send that stuff back to us. So we did kind of a broad one like that, and then we did a lot near the end. You know, every few days we would have people come in and play in a room, and we would stream the video to everyone, but in particular the designers could watch them play through, because there would usually be arguments about this is too hard or this isn't too hard, and then you do the stream, and then it's like, oh, okay. So there was quite a bit of playtesting, not as much as I would have liked.
Sure.
But there's never enough. But there was quite a lot.
Okay. And just one other quick thing, off the top of my head, difficulty as far as the adding the 2-player component. How did you worry about like adjusting difficulty there? Was it more of a thought, well, if playing 2 players it becomes just easier, or do you consciously try to make it more difficult to balance it out?
Yeah, so the question is, adding 2 players, How did we handle that? Were we concerned about that? Yeah, we were extremely concerned about that. There was a person on the team who was pushing for two players, and we were doubtful because there's a lot of costs associated, and he finally won us over. At a certain level, we kind of eventually accepted that the two-player game is going to basically be easier, but also harder because of the dimension swapping with the platforming, which kind of brutal, two players, which is why we added this bubbling mechanic where the second player can bubble. We just kind of accepted that it was going to be easier, that it wasn't probably going to get a lot of use from people. And I mean, there are adjustments, so it might not be obvious when you play, like basically the enemies become stronger.
Gotcha.
But very simple adjustments. Basically our attitude was, we played it, we had people play it, and we wanted to make sure that it flowed pretty well, but it wasn't our primary focus, we just wanted to make sure that it was reasonably good.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Hi. During your presentation, you were talking about how you always said yes to adding new personality in your game. Did you ever feel that there were times where ideas were presented that didn't really fit your game, and how did you decide that those should not be a part of the Guacamelee?
Yeah, so to repeat the question, we added a lot of personality, and I said that we said yes to lots of stuff, but how do you mediate stuff that doesn't fit with the vision? Yeah, I'm not sure quite how to answer that. I mean, the basic answer is, yes, we had problems with that, and the producer basically made the call. That was kind of the essence of it. I mean, that wasn't always true because, you know, sometimes, like, say the producer wants to push something out, but then the team kind of revolts on it and says, no, this must stay. And so the producer was, I kind of view the producer, it's like kind of like the prime minister in a prime ministerial system. It's like the prime minister is the leader, and he's kind of in charge, and he gets to say what goes, but he's still subject to the other ministers. The other ministers can boot him out of the cabinet, right? They can kick him out if they really don't like what he's doing, and that's kind of the attitude we took with it. Like, the producer is in charge, and he's going to make the hard calls, but the people on the floor can still kind of revolt over it as a collective if they need to, if they feel they need to.
All right, thank you.
If nobody else has any questions, I'll ask my question. I am Lily. I'm the product manager at Toon Boom Animation, and I love the art style in your game, and I think that's one of the things that really sets it apart. And I unfortunately was not able to attend the session that you guys had earlier about the art, but I just wanted to ask quickly, what was the pipeline that you used to get the artwork into your custom game engine, and were there any sort of problems that you're trying to address with that? We've just released a new version that exports to Unity seamlessly, but I'm kind of wondering what sort of challenges you faced in your pipeline.
So all the environment art is done in 3D Studio with Photoshop. All the effects are done in the engine using this kind of shader stuff that's programmer friendly. All the characters are drawn in Flash and exported to Swift. And then we have an importer in the engine that converts the Flash stuff to vector and then runs it. And it's done like that instead of like sprite sheets and stuff, because it means we can get like 60 frame per second animation, but the memory requirements are small. And I actually will say that we actually have started using Toon Boom as well.
Oh, great.
And because it's a cool tool. And we're hoping to integrate that into our pipeline, because it seems to support many of the similar things that Flash does.
Yeah, and one of the things that I noticed also, you have a heavy use of textures and stuff, and one of the things I think that Flash in the Swift format is not very sort of friendly with is the use of textures and textured lines and things like that. So.
Yeah, that's why mostly the characters do not contain textures.
Yeah.
They're basically just geometry, and then it's the environments that contain textures, because the environment artist is more comfortable. Well, it makes more sense to do it in 3D Studio with proper textures.
Right. Well, it looks beautiful. Good job.
Okay, well, thank you very much.